Hello, yes, cool, everybody can hear me. Welcome, my name is Miek Griebe. I'm currently SRE on GKE in Google, and I started Chordiness, the Chordiness project. I will not talk about Chordiness, although I use Chordiness for this presentation. Today I want to talk about stub resolvers and how they interact with your cluster DNS. So what is a stub resolver, actually? Luckily, we finally have a definition in the RFCs. It's a resolver that cannot perform all resolution by itself. You can read the lines. What does this mean? This is basically your libc translating your request into a DNS binary, putting it on the wire, and waiting for a reply. That's it. In C, we have get adder info, and get host by name was the older one. And in Go, you have lookup xxx. It's different. Functions you have in the Go runtime. So what implementations are popular? Glibc is basically the default libc on all Linux versions. Mussel-libc, a newer one, really, really small, and they aim to be small. It's a standard libc on Alpine Linux. And as I said, the Go standard library, if you compile it 100% statically, GCGO enabled is equal, you will use the Go implementation of the resolver. If you don't do that, it will fall back to whatever it's on the system, so either Mussel or libc. So what did I do? I wanted to see how these work with different configurations. And I'm doing a very simple thing, ping example.org in a Docker container where Chordiness is upstream, and Chordiness will do strange things to the reply, and we'll see how the libc's react to that. In Go, I wrote a small thing that does uses net lookup host. This always will send two queries, one for IPv4 and one for IPv6, which you can't disable. At least I couldn't find out how to do that. The testing code is all online on MeekG Stubs on GitHub if you want to play with it yourself. So why do you actually want to use Alpine Linux? While making the Docker containers, I use Debian for the glibc, and that is 70 megs, the Alpine 40 megs. So that's a big save of memory or disk space. If I compile Chordiness, it's 31 megs, because statically compiled. So I don't care that much that I save 50 meg on the OS if my binary alone is already 30 megs. And the 30 megs can get larger. But yeah, I like small images, so that's why Alpine is probably super, super popular. So how did I test this? My upstream is Chordiness. It binds to an interface, and I load one plugin, or two, the Erratic plugin. And Erratic is used for internal testing in the Chordiness code base. And this basically says one in three replies sent back truncated. And truncated in DNS means I have an answer for you, but your UDP buffer size is too small. I sent you what I have, but truncated, so there's more. Then we also load log, which will log a whole bunch of things. I will go in slightly more detail in what we see here. And this is basically the whole testing framework that I used. So if we log a thing, we get the request domain name, the type A or quad A, the class, which is always IN, relic from the past, the protocol, UDP or TCP, the buffer size, which is important for UDP. Like, this is my buffer size, this is the maximum amount of data I can receive on this call. The do bit, I should have removed that because it's pretty useless in this, and the flags that we will send back. So QR means query response, AA is, this is an authoritative answer. RD echoes back what the client wants, recursion desired, not that important. And the one that I didn't show is TC, which says truncation, it doesn't fit, you need to do something else. Let's test this. Glibc, you see the log, and you see the TC bit in bold. And great, you see TCP query, so it comes back with a new query. And for TCP, maximum size 64K. So we can put all the stuff in there, hopefully. Mussel-libc, we give TC, and we don't see anything. So Mussel, I don't know what, but it doesn't react to TC. In Go, you see both A and quad A, because it's impossible for me to disable that behavior. But it does the right thing. It gets a correct response on the A query, and then a truncated on the quad A query, and it comes back with TCP on the quad A. This is good. So, is this against the DNS standard or not? So, small intermission, the DNS standard, we had a presentation during the ITF from Bert Hubert. It's almost 3,000 pages of text that you need to read if you want to do everything, which is quite big. I'm not a C++ programmer, but he used this in this presentation. This is two times the C++ standard. So it's a lot of text that you need to read to actually know what the hell you need to do. So I thought, like, TCP, that's a big omission. So what do we actually say in the RFCs? One of the earlier RFCs, one of the first, 1034. Use of TCP may be the answer, but TCP may well place burdens on the host capabilities, blah, 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 blah. It's like, okay, maybe not, or only UDP. Another RFC. Must support UDP and should support TCP. Okay, so we don't have to do TCP. And this predates the official must and should standardization, so nobody really knows what you should do here. More than a decade later, what should you actually do on a truncated bit? Should ignore that response, query again, using a mechanism such as a TCP connection that will permit larger replies. Okay, seems to be, it is in the standard. And then finally, a couple of years back, stub resolvers, that's the thing we're talking about, must support TCP since they do. If they don't, interoperability will suffer. 23 years of ambiguity if it's actually supported or not. But finally, in 2010, we said, yes, if you want to be a stub resolver, you should do, or you must do, TCP as well. So officially, MuzzleLibC doesn't implement the full DNS spec. So how bad is this? If you want to dump as much as you want in... So if you don't implement TCP, the maximum size that you will see is 512 bytes, which is not a lot. That is the size they standardized DNS on in 1985-ish, 6-ish. So that's why it's 512 bytes. How much stuff do you actually can you fit in that size? 9 pieces of information, DNS information. That's it. There's a thing called compression, which in if you're lucky, you can actually compress the packet a bit. It will fit 13 RRs. That's it. If you know there are like 13 logical root servers, same reason, that fits in 512 bytes. That is not a lot, especially if you have a lot of pods running and you want to do server discovery. So this you can't, possibly you can miss quite a lot. So maybe there's an option in etc/resolve.conf that we can use. And etc/resolve.conf is the standard way on Unix to configure your libc. Has a couple of things, has a manual page on Linux that is pretty good, I assume on other Unixes as well. The domain and search keywords can be used but are mutually exclusive. And I will come back to domain and search, but actually how you can use them later on. And there's a thing in glibc that I found out, the search keyword can actually be overridden with an environment variable called local domain. Never heard of this, but apparently you can do this. So I was wondering if POSIX or any other standardization body says anything about the how a resolve.conf should look like. I couldn't find anything. Maybe I missed it, but I couldn't find a standard that says anything about it. It's not on the RFCs, because this is implementation. By the way, if there are questions, feel free to just yell out. So the different implementations, they all implement these keywords in etc/resolve.conf. The name server, which is your upstream that actually will get your query and will process it. There's only a maximum of 3 of those you can use. You can do more, but they will be silently ignored. So there's no warning of nothing. Luckily, all 3 implementations do the same thing here. They will silently ignore your stuff. Domain, that is a thing that will get added to your unqualified query. I have more to say about this. Is equal to search, just use search. Glibc limits this to 6 domains with a total of 256 characters. I'm not sure if this is per domain or the total thing, but it should be sufficient, but it still will be kept silently, no error whatsoever. And furthermore, there's options, which you can tweak some things for some implementations. Also, totally not standardized, even worse than etc/resolve.conf. So the options that there are is NDOTS, which they do all, luckily. NDOTS says when to do the initial absolute query. I will come back in more detail about this. Timeout, which is 5 seconds in glibc. Attempts, so if it times out, I will try again. By default, 2. So that's already 10 seconds if something fails. So 10-second timeout on your DNS query, that's quite painful. EDNS0, glibc only, will set a larger buffer size on your UDP. Can be useful. Use VC is an old word for do it with TCP, virtual circuit. I had to look it up because I'm too young. And rotate is not only use the first name server specified, but rotate a bit between them. Normally, if in your etc/resolve.conf, the first name server is always used first. Only when it times out, it will go to the second one.
You're missing at least one.
Am I missing options? Yes. Yes, there are there are loads more options. Read it on resolve.conf. MuzzleLibc doesn't do all of them. BSDs have different options you can set, but it's all not standardized. These are what I thought the most important ones. A note that Muzzle doesn't support rotate, because Muzzle will send queries in parallel if you have multiple name servers. It will do both, which is pretty smart, but from a DNS perspective can increase the load on your server. A note that Muzzle is pretty vocal on the differences from glibc, and I put this URL here, and I will repeat that URL, because you should read it if you're using Alpine and Muzzle. So test one of these crazy options, EDNS0. glibc, yep, larger buffer, twice the size, so we can fit 26 RRs in it. MuzzleLibc doesn't do anything with it. Go, also not. A non-standard thing, you can set it, the rest will ignore it, and yet a slight benefit in glibc. Use VC, yes, supported by glibc. Does TCP right away. I think it will still do 1 TCP connection per request. So expensive. The other ones, as you can see, will still use UDP. Note my DNS library also ignores this option. So no, that's why Go doesn't do it. Oh, Go has their own implementation. Only in glibc there's some use for these options, and vice versa, but I haven't found any that Muzzle or Go does that glibc doesn't. Okay, search. This is the resolve.conf in Kubernetes, in a pod. We have 1 name server, which is good, so we don't do parallel querying in Alpine. We have a search path, which is long-ish. And we have an option n.5, which means that we will follow the search path unless the query has more than 5 dots, which it's terribly bad. Note that NDOS is luckily silently kept at 15. I don't know why you want to have 15, but that's the max. So what does this mean for resolving DNS queries? NDOS 5 basically means that anything you want to look up on the internet will go through the entire search path before you get an answer. You know there's a way to not have this happening. a.b.w.google.com dot, that final dot, really, really important here, makes it an absolute query, will not go through the search path, will sidestep the whole thing. If you omit that dot, it will use the search path, depending on how many dots are left. My second example is actually wrong now that I see it, because I did use the final dot. Let's assume I didn't. The events that we see, the number of queries, is we will do www.google.com, first search path, default server cluster.local. That doesn't deliver an answer. So we go to the second one, we go to the third one, and finally we do the one that we actually want to look up. And hopefully we get a reply. So if you use this, and you are, because you're using Kubernetes, the number of search paths for any non-local name will just explode. So three times the amount of queries that you have. If you put a second name server in resolve.conf and you're using Alpine, parallel querying, so six times. There is a partial solution in CordianS called AutoPath, where we will do this on the server. So we will detect that we see that you're using the search path, and the server will walk the search path that it will get from the pod and give you the answer with some CNAME trickery. It's not a perfect solution, but it will cut down on the number of queries that the client will do. So in my testing setup, I use ping example.org. One dot smaller than five, what do I see? All the queries that I just showed. In Go, in this example, it's worse, but actually more standard-wise, because it does quad A as well, which is good, but it doubles the query load yet again. You can play with this thing yourself. It's a little plugin for CordianS. But yeah, this blows up the number of queries that we see quite a lot. And if you just do this, add the final dot, we see this. So make the damn things fully qualified. So what do we see in the, if you check all the features? glibc, UDP and TCP. Muzzle, only UDP. Note they document this. They tell you we don't do TCP. So they're pretty honest about that they're not doing it. Go does UDP and TCP, that's correct. glibc, the name service that it looks at resolve.conf, in order. Muzzle in parallel. Go also does it in order. The requery on TC, truncated. glibc, yes. Muzzle, no, because they don't do TCP. And Go does this as well. The largest packet size that we can return is 512 bytes for Muzzle libc. And there's no way you can get more. Largest UDP size, that is the EDNS0 option that you could use for glibc. So you get like a K, which is nice. Another thing that might be of interest, there's a thing called name server switch, NSS. That's also not supported by Muzzle libc, which is fine. Go only supports this when you're not statically compiling, because it needs to dynamically load a library. I put yes there, but it's basically yes and no. So what I will leave with this, I love Alpine because it's so super small, but it has a lot of differences in the libc implementation. So you have to be aware of the differences. I switched to Debian Slim, which is 70 megs for all the stuff, unless I have a statically compiled Go binary that I just put in Alpine, because I'm not using the libc. Go to that URL and read it, and decide what you want to do. Cool. Any questions? I yep. Yes. So there's DNS over HTTPS, which is not standardized yet, okay. But it's a draft that is coming. That is basically do DNS over HTTP2. I don't think this will be implemented in glibc. Muzzle libc, I don't know. Go maybe, but it's going to be tricky to do this on this level because it's an entirely new transport that is completely different than just UDP and TCP. So I've yeah, I can't say. I do know that in GoDNS, my library, we are going to implement it. So you can use it there. Yes? You mean local caching on the system?
Yeah.
There is a horrible thing called NSCD, I mean. You should disable that. As far as I'm aware, there is no caching unless you implement caching. No, there's no caching. You do a query, you get a response, and all the older utilities will just take that address and use it for a lifetime. So there is no on-host caching, unless you do DNS mask or whatever. Is it implemented local caching on the node on Kubernetes? No, I don't think so. But we might go there to make things better. But as far as I know, there is no local DNS caching on the node. Yep.
Having the dots on the end of the FPGN actually breaks some implementations when open SSL validates to your opinion. So who is responsible for spreading the extra dots?
So who is responsible for not caring about the last dot that shouldn't be there but is implicitly there? This is mostly the fault of the DNS RFC authors, I think, that they didn't make this explicit. And there is indeed some SSL implementations treat the name differently, which they shouldn't, but they do. Where does the blame lie? Badly written spec? Yeah, I don't know. But yeah, it's a problem, because if you can't do that, then you're doing a lot more queries to actually get a name, and that will increase latency. Yeah, sorry. I was 8 when they wrote this, so couldn't have been me. So, looking forward, DNSSEC and DNS over TLS. What is your question? Should glibc do DNS over TLS?
Yeah, what do you do?
Well, I'm mostly not using libc and do it in Go. The Go stuff is because I control it. TCP over TLS over TCP is supported, so that works. DNSSEC on this level is hard. Mostly what is going on is this will stay as it is, and either you run a local DNS server that talks DNSSEC upstream, or you go to a recursor that does DNSSEC upstream, meaning this path is not protected by DNSSEC at all, so you can still inject queries.
None of the libraries try to give anything back. I mean, there's no standard to
No.
Except for not returning anything or returning a server fail.
Yeah, that is how the standard is written, and the glibc implementation, because of backwards compatibility, can't even say there was an error in the DNSSEC resolution thing. So that's an unsolved problem, and I think the community, the DNSSEC community, moved on and tried to actually deploy it on the internet and then come back to this problem. Any other questions? Yep. Ah, sorry. That's two questions. So how is the move to core DNS to GA basically in Kubernetes going to be? That's question one. Question two, do you need to care about this in conjunction with that move? No, this is, you need to care about this right now. KubeDNS, the forwarding of queries is the slowest path. And if you need to do it 6 times to get a query resolved, or see a query 6 times, yeah, send the query 6 times before you actually get a response, that's extra latency. CoreDNS as GA will happen. There's some concerns about the process, like who owns the image. And if I'm on holiday and there is a security leak somewhere and they need to patch CoreDNS, do I need to dial in from my holiday destination, or can the Kubernetes project just push new code? So we need to finalize that and write that down. And it means also some other things that are now vendored, like etcd, will get the same treatment. So we're going to write that down, and that's, we need that first, and then we can go GA.
Yep. Sorry, one more.
Yeah, fine.
Regarding the option I was mentioning earlier, do you know how you handle the different, handle the UDP socket? Because in DNS, you have a transaction ID or a request ID. You can use one socket and request two things, two IDs, or use two independent sockets. And on libc, there's the single request option, which is used for bloody old packet filters because they don't track the state of the UDP socket.
Do we have single requests in Go?
Yeah, we use two DNS sockets for A and 1A.
In Go DNS, we use two DNS sockets. I don't know what the Go library does, because there's my Go DNS package, and there is the core standard library that also does DNS. You know, Dave? I think it just opens a new socket for every UDP connection. Yeah, because that's pretty much the easiest thing to do. Yep.
But every Cisco
yeah, a single request also came back in the discussion last week about the connection tracking that Kubernetes does, where there is a race condition in the Linux kernel, which means if you do an A and a quad A, it will pick a port. That picking of a port is racy, so the two requests will get the same port. Then the first one comes back, will be delivered, and the second one comes back, and then the kernel says, I don't know what to do with it, and drops it. Yeah, yeah, and that means you don't see the quad A, so you get your 5-second timeout, and then another query, and then you get your response, which is, which is painful. That is the default timeout. So yeah, that hurts. That really hurts. Any other questions? Cool. Then thank you. Thank you for coming.